And here we are at the Jubilee Hall, built by Mr. Newson in 1876 to celebrate Queen Victoria's Golden Jubilee. Originally designed for concerts and dramatic experiences by well-known artists, and dances for the little people on a wet afternoon and for grown-ups in the evening. But right now I want you to imagine we're somewhere else, that this is London, the year is 1860, and this is the Middlesex Hospital and the start of Elizabeth's journey into becoming a doctor.
We have a letter here from one Miss Elizabeth Garrett, daughter of Mr. Newson Garrett, a prominent businessman in Auburn, asking to be taken on as a medical student at the Middlesex.
What?
A medical student.
We have her who's just taken money and signed up.
You know, a female medical student.
A woman? As a medical student? Preposterous! She wants to be a nurse, she wants to be.
No, definitely a medical student.
Well, out of the question. And moreover, an insult to the female sex to boot. Women in the operating theatre? You fainting all over the place.
Nurses endure it.
Nurses assist. They don't go cutting the flesh. Mm. And anyway, nurses are of the lower orders. This woman is of a high class family. We can't have well brought up young ladies exposed to male members and buckets of gore.
Well, the nurses endure it.
It's not all about male members. There are many women and children who need care.
And they'd rather have a well-qualified man than a self-taught herbal woman. That went out in the Dark Ages. Pokery, pokery, what?
Well, William Smiley, as you know, the father of midwifery, taught women in 1741.
And now, thank God, the Royal College of Surgeons have seen more sense.
Well, more women midwives would free up male doctors for more important work.
Does she want to be a midwife then?
No. Wants to be a surgeon.
Anyway, women haven't got the brains. They're good for staying at home, looking after the children, knitting, looking after the house, that sort of thing. But studying, it would give them nervous exhaustion and possibly madness.
I cannot help observers look around, that there are many physicians and surgeons who do not appear to be superior in ability to the average woman.
Well, it's impossible. The Act doesn't allow it.
The Medical Act of 1858 does not forbid it. It does, however, state that the applicant should be a gentleman and a scholar.
Well, there you have it. Can't be a gentleman, being a woman, what?
Equally, she cannot be a scholar. There are no degree courses open for women.
What about the distraction? Women in the operating theatre, the male students are rowdy lot of better times.
So it's a no then?
Damn right it's a no. Next!
Dear Emily, well, I'm finally in. On the 1st of August, 1860, at 8 of the clock, I passed through the doorway of the Middlesex Hospital with my apron on and my notebook in my hand. I am ready to begin my stint of nursing to see if I can endure the sights, smells, and sounds of a real-life hospital. It is an impressive building, standing in the crowded streets of Soho. I have thought carefully about my dress and have worn something practicable but smart. Everyone seems to fear my health and my nerves will break down, but I am determined. I start my day preparing dressings, spreading ointment, cutting lint, and rolling bandages. I then accompany the ward sister on her rounds, where I am allowed to redress the simpler wounds. Regular bleeding for any ailment seems to be on the wane, but Mr. Briggs, cupper to the hospital, still comes every morning for his orders. I observed a minor operation on the ward yesterday, performed by Mr. Nunn, who allowed me to watch and explained what he was doing. I asked questions and he seemed impressed. He has offered to take me to his outpatient clinic. Dr. Willis also allowed me to accompany him on his rounds. I long to get into the operating theatre, but I am taking my time.
Was that old woman I saw accompanying the students the other day to the operating theatre?
Yes. Yes, Miss Garrett. A volunteer here at the hospital and very keen to learn.
A woman!
Mr. Norman Dean recommended I pay her some attention. She seems very bright.
You mean she hasn't fainted yet or vomited?
Not at all. And it is obvious that she is reading up in her spare time. She is certainly doing more study than most of my male students.
Ah, she won't last.
Dr. Willis has offered to teach her. Mr. Plaskett is taking her on in the pharmacy.
Does she want to be an apothecary then?
No. She's determined to be a doctor. I have a letter asking if she could be taken on formally as a student.
Well, the answer's no. It's still no, and it always will be no.
Dear Emily, things are going amazingly well. In spite of not being an official student, Dr. Willis is teaching me anatomy and physiology 3 times a week. And Mr. Plaskett is teaching me Latin, Greek, and Materia Medica. Drugs to you. I am supplementing his knowledge with chemistry instruction from a Miss Drewley, although her dress sense worries me. Short petticoats and round hats, I mean, really. I try to dress well, but soberly, as I think it helps the men take me seriously. It is strange, but there really is no awkwardness between us, men and women working together on equal terms. It is a revelation to me and to them, I think. I go into the operating theatre on a regular basis, and I'm amazed at the cavalier way that some of the doctors go about their business. 40% of cases die on the table. Could it be that their coats are encrusted with the blood of previous cases? Florence Nightingale is making it her mission to bring more cleanliness to hospitals and is making sure that nurses are well trained and sober. I do agree with her. I have finally been given a room at the hospital for dissection. I no longer have to carry bits and pieces to Louis's house, for which he is eternally grateful. It is strange, but each doctor seems to be willing to help me privately and singly, but they are afraid to countenance the movement by helping me in their collective capacity. This will come in time, I trust. The good news is that I have paid and will now be allowed to officially attend lectures and take the certificates in each subject. This will amuse you, Emily. I had to sign to say that I would not smoke in the garden or the hospital and that I would comport myself in every way a gentleman. I think I'm on my way at last.
I have here a letter signed by the medical students. The memorial drawn up against Miss Elizabeth Garrett. to prevent her attending any more lectures.
Come!
Or being taken on formally as a student.
Knew it would come to this in the end. What's she done? Vomited? Fainted? Had the vapors?
No. It appears she's shown them up. She sat the exams and got top marks in every discipline.
You mean she's been attending lectures?
The students tolerated her at first, thinking of her a lark, but she'd been getting ahead of herself, answering all of the questions before them, and getting them right.
Good heavens! Is it unanimous?
Five students stood up for her, but it was by the majority.
What do our tutors say?
Oh, they say she's bright, attentive, no trouble, if a bit on the big-headed side. Yeah, but they fear if they stand up for her, the students will leave in droves, and the financial implications for the hospital would be immense.
I have here a letter from her father, offering to endow a medical scholarship for women at the Middlesex, to offset any financial loss.
But it wouldn't, would it? It would be earmarked for his daughter. No use to the other students at all.
Well, yes.
So what were the main concerns? Apart from her being a woman, which I would have thought was concern enough.
Well, they seem disrespectful to the chosen profession. They're making the Middlesex a laughing stock and against the Constitution.
We can't bring the Middlesex into disrepute for one woman.
Well, we can't dismiss her immediately. She's paid up until the end of the term.
Well, let her sit it out until the end of the term if she must. But after that, she's out.
Right. Excellent.
Dear Emily, I'm heartbroken, but not defeated. I will live through this somehow. Find another way. Do not write to the papers or protest for me. That will only damage my chances of finding another place elsewhere. I am back in Aldbury now, licking my wounds. Yesterday, I did receive a letter from the Apothecary's Hall. Apparently, their charter does not restrict women, so they have agreed to admit me qualifying exams for a license. I do still need formal qualifications, but I can only obtain these with a degree. I am determined to write to every college and medical school. Father thinks petition in the University of London is the best, as it is in the process of changing its charter. They put up leaflets and flyers supporting our cause. You can avail yourself of one of these when you next come to London. Mother sees it as a sign from heaven to give up. I do not, and neither does Father. And America is not an option. I want to find a way to qualify in this country. Anyway, the medical register is now closed after they realised that they had signed up Dr. Blackwell. Perhaps I will do as John Barry did and dress as a man. Only joking. One thing is certain. I will never, ever underestimate the difficulties again.
Poor lad. Although I always do say, never wrestle with a Coleman when you're wearing a white suit.
The way to Babylon will never lead you to Jerusalem.
Or thought, Ness.
We never needed doctors in our house. We had recipes passed down to my mother from her mother before her and her mother before her.
A bit like incest then. Keep it in the family.
We had a good one for jaundice. You roast a lemon in a dram of tamarisk, then you take 60 old sows, wood lice to you, and you drown them in a vat of old beer with a red hot horse's shoe and a pennyworth of brimstone. You put it in a horse's urine, and you drink it three times a day for a week.
I think I'd rather have the jaundice. Anyway, the London University had to vote, and 10 voted for and 10 voted against, changing the charter to allow women in. So the casting vote went to Lord Granville, and he voted no, the miserable old git. Oxford turned her down, and so did Cambridge, and even tried St Andrews.
That's in Scotland, ain't it, Mr Barham?
That's right.
I know, because my brother went there. He said it was very cold. And they be a strange people. Put us amongst the monkeys, they all make faces at him.
Anyway, she managed to get the admission fee, and she gave it to the bursar. But he gave it back to her the following morning with a letter of apology. Now, one of the senior lecturers at the university, he was very supportive, a bit like my trust. And they worked together privately for the whole of that winter. But by the summer of 1863, she was back in London, writing to all the doctors, trying to get back in all the wards, just so she could take those exams.
She even managed to sneak back into the Middlesex for a bit, which I thought was very brave of her considering what they'd done. Don't you think, Mr. Barham? Some are like gold, refined in the furnace of affliction.
Anyway, by the autumn of 1865, she'd attended all the lectures, and because she'd been apprenticed to Mr. Boscott for 6 years, she passed the
apothecary
preliminary exams with credit. But as one door shuts, another slams in your face. And there was another problem waiting.
They threatened to stop me, the Board of Examiners.
What? I threatened them with legal action and they backed down.
They let me sit the exams and then they immediately changed their terms so that nobody else could go the same route. My aim to promote women has failed.
But you're still qualified, a qualified doctor.
No.
What?
Not a doctor, never a doctor until I have my MD. But I do have LSA after my name. So I can open a clinic.
I've leased a house for her. 20 Upper Berkeley Square, very respectable.
Well, just what we need. A London-based petition the Commons for suffrage.
This is my clinic.
Well, you don't need all of it. We have a champion now. John Stuart Mill has been elected on a ticket to get women a vote. Without the vote, we'll never get anywhere. We need 15,000 signatures just for his motion to be heard in Parliament.
You mustn't distract her. She's worked hard for this.
Oh, this is just a start. There are far more barriers to climb and rivers to cross.
I know! And I will get my medical degree sometime soon, but at the moment I am very busy in my clinic, and of course there's Jane's work to get involved in.
Not our old friend Jane Crow.
Jane is sharing a house. It would be improper for Elizabeth to live alone.
These old-fashioned ideas.
No, I don't mind. Really, I don't. I still have more independence than any other single woman in London. And Jane is secretary for the Society for the Promotion of Independence of Women. So we have many like-minded friends.
I'm proud of you, as proud as I've ever been. Your brothers are proud of you, your sisters are proud of you. Even your mother's proud of you. I heard her praying only the other night, thanking God for all your gifts.
Barbara Boudichon is planning a visit that will coincide with Gladstone's reform bill. It was she who first approached John Stuart Mill. Oh, you will come with us and present the petition.
Elizabeth is busy now. She's got patients to see and things to do.
Of course I'll come. You just try and stop me.
So that was on the bill. And the motion was raised by Mill to raise the name from man to person in the bill. Of course they lost, but the women succeeded in getting 73 votes, which they saw as a success. Now, in 1865 there was an outbreak, an epidemic in Egypt. Asiatic cholera. This was the most dangerous disease of that century, and it actually reached London. And it was a disease that did not distinguish between rich or poor.
I've got a recipe for that one too.
We thought perhaps you might have, Jenny. Does it work?
Well, yes and no.
How do you mean?
Well, they still die, but in less pain.
God give me strength. Well, anyway, Elizabeth fully exploited this epidemic, and she opened up a dispensary. And by the time the epidemic was over, she had adopted the situation of a dispensary by women for women. And in the first year alone, she saw 3,000 odd patients. She also saw a load of poor people, too poor to pay, free of charge. And her nights were frequently broken up by midwifery duties. You would have gleaned then that she worked damned hard, but of course she was learning all the time, weren't she?
But in every rose bush there be thorns.
And hopefully roses.
A little time may chance to hatch a great deal of mischief. A wonder lasts but 9 days and then the puppy's eyes be open.
And empty vessels make most noise. I think we get the picture, Jenny.
Well, would you be wanting some of that tea now, Mr. Barham, with something a little stronger in it?
Have you got something a little stronger?
I always have a little something about me person. Never know when you might need a little nip on a cold day.
Depends on where you get nipped, I suppose. Anyway, trouble was round the corner like it normally is, and this time it befell on little Louis. Elizabeth's older sister, and forever her confidant.
Thank you. was a darling. There's nothing more to be said.
I wish it had been me.
No, you don't.
She had four children. I am alone. Her four children are motherless.
You have much good work ahead of you.
What was all the use of that training if I could not save her?
I'm sure you did your best.
She needed surgery, but that's still in its infancy. All I had was hot poultices and opium.
How is James coming?
Very well in circumstances. I promised her I would look after the children, and I will.
With all your other responsibilities?
Of course, it's the least I could do after all that she did for me.
Oh, Emily. I didn't know you were here.
I just arrived, Lydia. I'm so sorry.
We all distraught. I wanted to postpone the wedding, but Lizzie wouldn't hear of it.
Did I tell you? Millie is to marry Henry Fawcett.
The blind politician.
What with him being so old, many have said I'm being poor. But he's so kind and gentle, and Father has really taken to him. And he's Lizzie's friend, of course.
Indeed.
He's so cultured and educated, but such fun to be with as well. He never lets his disability stop him. He escaped at Ely and walked the gogs at Cambridge. He's such stories, and he's determined to bring women's suffrage to the fore in the house. We all work together on it. Oh, can I offer you some refreshment, Emily?
Oh, that would be kind, thank you.
Does she know?
No, and you must never tell her.
But won't Henry tell her eventually?
I have forbidden him to mention it under pain of death.
Oh.
It was his proposal to me was a long time ago. It would do none of us any good to be reminded of it.
And how do you feel?
We were good friends. But we would not have made a good marriage. The time was not right. I do not regret turning him down. In fact, I did not think he meant right first for Millie, and I argued most vehemently against the match. But they won me over, and now I think it is for the best.
Well, I think you're very brave.
Brave? I don't feel brave, Henry. I feel alone. Alone and defeated.
But you've achieved so much. St. Mary's is a triumph. You have a thriving medical practice and your reputation is growing.
My clinic is full to capacity, it is true. And I'm in a position I love. My time is fully occupied. But I still have not achieved my aim. And Louis' death has brought it home to me how fragile life is, how little time we have. If I do not achieve this, then who will? And I'm lonely, Emily. I never realized it before.
Do you think you should have accepted Henry when he asked you?
Goodness, no. We were wrong for each other, very wrong. But the loss of Louis has brought it home to me. Maybe I need a shoulder to lean on sometimes. A kind word at the end of the day. Someone to care for me.
There's a letter for you, miss.
Oh, was it from you?
Don't know, it's in French, miss.
French? Well, I never.
Can I get you anything, Miss Davies?
Oh, no, thanks. Really has one.
That'll be all, thank you, Jenny.
All right, miss. The stone that lies not in your road need not offend you.
She has persisted on knocking on their doors for me. Oh. It seems that the Paris Medical School is opening up its doors to women.
But I thought you were holding out to qualify in this country.
Oh, well, that's impossible. All doors are shut to me. But if I could get my M.D. Well, then perhaps I could get on the medical register such as Dr. Blackwell did. Then I could start to practice. Then I could open up my own medical school for women. Work from the inside out, so to speak.
But you can't just abandon your clinic and decamp to Paris for years.
Oh, I have no wish to sit through any more of their lectures. Anyway, I could probably teach them far more than they could teach me. No, what I want is permission to sit the 6 examinations.
But they'll all be in French.
Then hurrah for the Miss Dickinsons, who insisted on conversational French at Blackheath. I must draft a letter immediately.
Well, who to?
Lord Lyons, British Ambassador. If he cannot open doors for me, then nobody can.
Translation.
But the proof of the pudding is in the eating, eh? Clara.
Well, you might better put there yourself.
Well, that's handy, because I happen to have in my basket a bit of pie only a day old. Now, what do you say to that, Mr. Barnes?
I would say, we don't mind if I do.
Mademoiselle Kent, we are here today to pronounce on your success or failure of the past month's examination.
Doctor, as you know, it was only after the personal intervention of Empress Eugene herself that we were willing to examine you without the required French certificates of study from the Sorbonne. I must admit, I voted against your first acceptance. But Lord Lyons, the British ambassador, presented a compelling case for you as a practicing physician of 3 years standing.
I see all of France was aware of your struggles in Scotland.
Even so, I fear an influx of women if the door is open a crack.
Nevertheless. Doctors were overruled and we come here today to pronounce our judgment.
I was impressed with your first exam in front of the students and the lecturers. You answered clearly and consistently.
A clear pass. Second part was in surgery and pathology. Two operations in public view with a Voce examination. And you passed with a bien satisfied. See, I guess mark.
The third examen was in chemistry, zoology, natural philosophy, and botany.
I was sure that this would show your weakness.
The pass, once again, was bien satisfied. The highest class gained since the beginning of the session by any student.
The fourth was in medical jurisprudence, material medica, and hygiene.
Once again, yes, but
the fifth was in clinical medicine, midwifery, and surgery.
Here, we found a small hole.
You were unable to answer a question from the great Dr. Graves of Dublin. Ha! Mademoiselle, vous ne connaissez pas d'or, vous prenez?
You do not know your great man?
That is what I said.
Mais, monsieur, nous en avons trop. We have so many.
It was a good answer, you must have.
So, to the last examination, your thesis, Sir Ludwig Green.
The headache.
You have not devoted your observations to mere headache, but to the severe disability of migraine proper, showing the interdependent relationship between pains in the head and gastric disturbance. You continue to recommend for the reduction of severity and frequency, simple food, avoidance of alcohol,
what?
Exercise, and a good ventilation.
And the great British cup of tea.
British cup of
tea. We agreed with both your diagnosis and the suggested recommendation.
I have to say, there have been further protests from the Sorbonne.
But the Minister of Public Instruction has overruled them. Oh. So I am pleased to tell you that your thesis has been well-sustained forever and sustained. You have passed. That was a Garrett. with flame colours, and we are willing to award you an MD. Congratulations and bon chance.
I wish you were here to share this.
I am here. I will always be here.
Oh, I miss you so much, Louis. I would never have got this far if it had not been for you. I owe you so much.
And you will accomplish so much more.
Who will I confide in now? Emily is busy with her college, Billy is married, and father is getting older.
What about James?
James?
You know who I mean.
James Skelton Anderson. Yes, I should write to him and tell him the news.
You're blushing.
No, I'm not.
I thought there was a spring in your step. He's a good man, and he believes in you.
Know about that. He had his doubts about appointing me a visiting medical officer for the East London Hospital.
But he came round. And he's handsome.
That's not a consideration.
No, but it helps. And he's from a good family.
Religious. Presbyterian.
But Free Kirk now. His father thought nothing of uprooting his family when his conscience got the better of him and at the age of 40 founding a new career as a headmaster. That's tenacity. Good stock.
Stock or not, I think I am past the age of marrying and anyway, why would James Anderson think of me in that context? He is a confirmed bachelor.
I think he is already thinking of you.
Rubbish. We hardly know each other. We have very little in common. His business lies in shipping.
You have known his brother Ford for years. His sister wishes to study medicine. You have worked on the hospital board. And you have said it yourself. You see eye to eye on most things.
No, his business lies in he owns his own business and shipping and cargo and everything. I have my work. Even more so now that I am a qualified doctor. I have seen him. I do not think he is interested in women. He has turned down many an eligible match.
He's not interested in conventional women.
If I were to marry, he would have to be an exceptional man. One who would allow me to continue my career, let me have my own money and property. Well, he would have to come second to all my patients, all the demands on my time. No man would embrace all that.
Do you like him?
Well, yes, but that's not the point.
Then write to him.
What about?
Tell him about your achievements in Paris. Be open-minded, open-hearted. See what comes.
Dear Mr. Anderson, the day of my triumph. I have been tested and not found wanting. I am now a qualified doctor. Drink to my becoming a great physician on my return to London with 30 years of vigour before me. I look forward to seeing you then. We will have much to talk about.
So, is that it, Mr. Barrett?
No. For that we must go up to Wednesday start at St. Peter and Paul Church, for the year is 1880 and Mr. Newson has just been elected mayor.
Well, we can't leave the story here.
Oh, we'll be neatly tied up and revealed in the church.
And then will you be ready for that bit of pie, Mr. Barham? Old birds could not be caught with chaff.
I think I might be ready for a little bit by then. After all the family will be at the ceremonies, and I will have time on my hands.
When the cat's away, the mice will play, Mr. Barham?
No, truths must never be told at all times. Right, ladies and gentlemen, we are now off to the church for the celebrations.
Yet he has always been regarded with affection and respect. So
When following the report on the 1880 Municipal Corporation Act, the corporation was reformed, Mr. Garrett was duly elected mayor. And this is an exceedingly important achievement for him, the first mayor. A man of so many achievements, but I think his best and most lasting memory will be the impact his family has had on national life, especially his daughters. Millicent heads the women's suffrage movement. Agnes has made her way into the architectural and design trade, and Elizabeth has made huge inroads into the world of medicine. It wasn't for the foresight and support, both financially and in kind, of Mr. Garrett, these things would never have happened. I call on him now to say a few words. Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Rector. I hope for all our differences over the years, there's no lasting ill will. I am indeed honoured to be elected the first mayor of Albright, particularly as I'm not a homegrown son. But it's not about myself that I wish to speak, but my daughter, Elizabeth. From an early age, I saw the spark in her, and I could do nothing but help that spark ignite into a flame. When she first spoke of me, of her desire to study medicine, I must admit I was appalled. Like many others, I felt that the operating theatre was not a place for the female of the species. But she proved me wrong, as she has so many times. After her triumph in Paris, she returned to stand in the elections for the London School Board, becoming the first successful woman candidate and ending not merely top of the poll for Marylebone, by getting more votes than any other London candidate. The Times wrote of her, "If Miss Garrett once enters the House of Commons, taking her seat with a little rustle of her dress, then the supremacy of man is at an end." I do not think they need to worry on that score. She is fully occupied with medicine. She owed much to the organiser of her campaign, James Skelton Anderson, and in recognition of his services, agreed to marry him. joking apart, I must admit that when he first came to the house, I was not happy. I felt that a husband, any husband, would not be worthy of her. However, he won over the family with his rendition of the Skyboat song. And since then, the wedding has proved me wrong again. They have made a wonderful partnership, basing their marriage on warm personal love, utter truth, and outspokenness. To a strong-willed woman, there is profound reassurance in the companionship of an even stronger man. Through the joy of a son, Alan, a daughter named after her beloved sister, Louis, and of course the pain of their daughter Margaret's death, they have held together. Elizabeth has continued her work, culminating in the opening of her new hospital for women, which grows and thrives. I am proud of all of my daughters, and my sons too, of course, but Elizabeth is without doubt my crowning glory. And through her life, she has convinced a reluctant society that a woman could qualify for an exacting profession, and in it win the trust of her colleagues. I call on her now to step forward and say a few words.
Thank you, Father. One of my first memories was being allowed to watch the fairy tale scene of the Queen and Prince Albert in procession to the Italian opera on my father's shoulders. His strong shoulders have been there for me ever since. I was 4 years old, and my next journey would be the cold and comfortless journey to the windswept jetty of Slaughton Quay. But I knew that my father was to be trusted, and I did trust him. He taught me strength of character, bloody-mindedness, and sheer determination, as well as a love of nature, an independence way ahead of our time.
I had no idea where life would take me, or when I started on this course, how difficult it would be to qualify as a doctor. I needed to be a scholar and a gentleman, both of which were denied me due to the lack of provision for women in education and by accident of birth. But I was determined, and I have my beloved father to thank for his foresight and vision in allowing me to be educated with support, money, and time as I struggle to win through the male bastions of prejudice and propriety. I have proved that sex is no barrier to the any path that one might want to take. Women are not harmed by regular, steady work. On the contrary, many of the most miserable cases in women are due to the want of it. I have achieved much, but there is much more to be achieved. My new hospital for women is a teaching hospital, but I am still the only one on the British Medical Register. Women are again barred. We still do not have a voice in Parliament. Education for women is still in its infancy, but we fight on. I come from a family where innovation is in the blood, but I do recognize also the role of others who have helped me in my achievements. Dr. Blackwell, who first helped me on the path, Mrs. Barbara Beauchamp, who introduced me to her, Emily Davis, my best and wisest friend, and even Sophie Jex-Blake, with whom I never saw eye to eye, but whose passionate campaigning has opened up more fields in medical education than my prodding ever could have done. Not least, my dear husband, who has been my rock and my stay since we married. Today, I congratulate my father on becoming mayor. It would be a wonder indeed if one day I might follow him into this office and break down another male bastion. In the meantime, I will continue to fight for women's rights in education, medicine, and in politics. I will fight until my dying breath.